Walmart like impact over corporate farms versus family owned similar farms. And it really does have a different impact. So that was awesome. So thank you guys.
Yeah. And Blair, I think I'd like to ask you to see if you can show the, which one? Farm Bill, the Farm Doc. I guess. The 2018 Farm Bill. That's okay. The one that I wanted you to show because that the first page of that shows some of what George and I were just talking about support.
Okay. And do you just want me to put that in the comments?
Please. Yeah. Well, actually, if you could screen share that. Go ahead. Go ahead and put it on Facebook. But if you could open that up.
Okay.
It's just a good little talking point there.
Just give me a moment.
And so I had a really great conversation with a local farmer on Wednesday afternoon. I called him to invite him to attend this town hall and just to ask him, you know, the things that I'm interested in learning about our farmers and what their concerns are. And I don't have his answer yet. I'm still trying to research it, but he pointed out that our rural roads have weight limits, and there are times when they need to move equipment from one field to another, or more urgently, get grain to a grain silo, and they have to have a permit to travel on the roads when. When they're overweight, and that was something very interesting that, you know, as a person who lives in town and I don't live on a farm, I've never had that experience, and I appreciate that question, and that is much more of a county board and a county issue. I was hoping that we would have one or two of our county board members attending tonight, but I don't see them here in the attendees to answer that question. Have you ever heard that, George? That
And I know the permitting process to try to keep a record of how much weight's going over roads during harvesting and the suspension of that for that. But I think on a federal level for that interest is. The rural roads, the amount of transportation that goes over that for farming is certainly can be a federal issue because not all rural areas have the funding directly to be able to maintain those roads and bridges. And there's a lot of weight that comes over those bridges and roads. And it's certainly, as we see right now, the infrastructure all across America, but especially in rural areas, really needs to be addressed because not having that infrastructure and not being able to utilize the transportation of all of those things really affects the food, the food trade throughout the country. So, on a federal level, we need to make sure that all those roads are invested in those infrastructure. And one is, you know, to bring some jobs back to those rural areas and road building and maintenance of bridges and infrastructure, policy that addresses that provides adequate transportation needs to the agriculture community also can begin to boost those communities as well by providing jobs. And there's badly, I mean, if people have ever been out on some of the country roads, I mean, there's badly needed improvement in infrastructure that goes on. And we need to make sure that we continue to invest in that from the federal level, knowing that that's not just a local issue, because what comes out of these areas is a global, you know, it's a global benefit for our GDP, but also for the food supply. We need to make sure that all of those things are continuing to be maintained and are to the level that farmers need them to be.
Right. And I do know that one benefit that we get from wind farms is that if, you know, when a wind farm is planned in an area, they have to have paved roads to get the equipment to the wind farms. So that's why if you're driving around the country roads, you find anywhere near a wind farm, it's all paved. You don't find nearly as many gravel roads. People who oppose wind farms something, it's something to think about.
There's certainly an ancillary benefit there. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And on the, but on the other hand, we need to make sure that our wind farm companies are holding up their end of the agreement, because my understanding is, and this came from a question I had at a meet and greet event I had in McLean, Illinois, and a resident pointed out that some of the wind farms are supposed to maintain the roads, and he did not feel like they were maintaining the roads to the level of their expected commitment. So it's something that we need to pay attention to.
Yeah, and I'm glad you bring that up, because I was in Logan County in Lincoln yesterday at an event, and I talked to a gentleman who was a retired electrical worker but lives out in an area where there's a planned wind farm community. And I mean, we talked a little bit about the nuisance that wind farms can have on landowners and on agriculture. And then we started to talk, because he has some experience with it, on the economics of some of the alternative energy sources that we're using or trying to build up and trying to invest mm-hmm. in. And I think we need to take a pragmatic look at it and see, it's great that we invest in these technologies and try to make them cheaper and more affordable. Well, we also need to recognize some of maybe the, and I don't want to call them nuisances, but some of the obstruction that they can have on landowners and agriculture. And also mm-hmm. if we're looking at them, are they beginning to be beneficial? Is the technology emerging to the point where they are useful, or are we continuing to invest in infrastructure and in a technology that we could be diverting to somewhere else? And so I know, mm-hmm. especially in the agricultural areas, wind farms are contentious to a point. And I want people to know, I absolutely hear and understand that. And we definitely need to look at that and at solar. And, you know, there's all, you know, four or five different ones that we can look at and see, are these actually working? You know, ethanol subsidies, are these actually working? Or is this building on a technology that really is going to be able to be scaled and usable? Or was it, you know, an attempt and an investment that maybe we don't continue to pursue because we're not reaping the benefits of it like we should. Mm-hmm. I don't think we should stop continuing to invest in those technologies and trying to build those, but we definitely need to take a closer look at, are we just putting them up to say that we're doing it, or do we know that these are actually working and that we're working mm-hmm. towards a scale that they're going to be very usable and beneficial and actually a replacement for some of the polluting energy that we have, some of the coal and natural gas and things like that. So again, wind farms it's an interesting topic to discuss mm-hmm. because then we have those where you get a promise of a benefit of maintenance of roads. And if we're not holding people accountable, that's also one of those downfalls of the side, that if we're not actually seeing the benefit of it, do we continue to allow that to happen?
Right. And another comment I had about the wind farms is the observation that the energy produced by our local wind farms is not actually used by us sure. locally. There mm-hmm. are very few actual windmills in our area that are producing electricity right here for us. And Heartland Community College is one. Their windmills produce electricity for Heartland College. But most of the other windmills in our area, the energy is
Put on the grid and sold off.
It's just put on the grid.
Again, another analysis of the way we're doing something, that does that make practical sense? And if it's not benefiting people directly here, is it worth the effort for us to continue to do it if we're not benefiting here? And also, if people want to utilize that individually on a farm, should we, and I think we absolutely should, is make sure that we have tax credits and incentives there for people to be able to utilize that. Mm-hmm. Especially when it's used directly on a facility. I mean, that's great that they can offset that by doing it. And if, you know, they want to bring that on, and if a farmer wants to bring that on, we need to make sure and encourage that they're doing that, because that's directly helping the community right there, and
right.
not just allowing somebody to take advantage of it for their own profit and leave us in this community with the con of it, with the downside of it. So
yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah, I see Joyce's question here about.
We also have a second yep. comment that actually came in right before that.
Okay, sure.
So I would like to address that. Somebody mm-hmm. said that the question is, well, two comments. Aren't townships supposed to take care of rural farm access roads? And then also, solar is not competitive with fossil fuels, and why coal is on its way out. I don't know if you guys have any comments about that.
Yes, yes, you are correct. Townships are supposed to take care of the rural roads. However, you know, the analogy or the comment that I was addressing from a resident was that they understood that there was an agreement for the wind farm company to participate in maintaining that road. You know, we'd have to look at those contracts and those agreements and make sure that the township is holding the windmill farm accountable or working with them to maintain the roads together. However it is that works.
Thank you very much. And I know you saw the other question, so I'll go ahead and let you ask and address it.
Right. Yeah. So the first part is what other problems do wind farms cause to farmers other than having something in their field? I'm not sure that they do cause a problem actually to farmers directly. I think people just sometimes don't like the look of them.
I don't know of any direct influence other than it takes up some of the land, and then they just consider them somewhat of a nuisance that it's
they have to drive
right there,
they have to drive around them
and those types of things, and I think a little bit just on they feel like it's sort of shoved in their face without them necessarily wanting it. I think it's one of those little things that people like the idea but not in their backyard type thing. And that's when we talk about other types of alternative energy sources, and then when we talk about modern nuclear as opposed to what was nuclear 40 or 50 years ago, everybody likes the concept and it seems it sounds great, but nobody wants it anywhere near there. And then in the grand scheme of things, if nobody wants it though, is it a solution that we need to continue to even explore? Is it something that we want to look at other sources? And yes, so coal, and I know the number of coal-fired power plants around here are beginning to phase out, and we're looking at all those alternative fuels. And that's why I think we need to keep an open mind, because we know that especially coal around here is it's very abundant, but it's also very dirty. And so I think at the short term, beginning to invest or continuing to invest in technologies that make it cleaner to use as we're using it, but also invest in what is more of a renewable, cleaner energy, not just for the purpose of the environmental impact, but also the stability, because the energy demands that we're going to have continue to increase and increase and increase. And also oil is not endless, so it's going to run out at some point. And also typically comes, we've done a good job of being able to find and harvest the oil and natural resources that we have here available in the U.S. and around the surrounding areas, but typically it comes from areas that are politically more unstable. And that also creates some uncertainty into our access to the energy needs that we have right now. But one of the things that I've talked about and like to highlight is if we continue to invest in new forms of energy and cleaner, renewable, cheaper forms of energy, we'll be able to be an energy leader on the global scale, because all of the developing economies right now that are still relying on fossil fuels and on coal, you know, in China, in India, in large populated areas, in Africa, in parts of South America, if we're able to advance those technologies and export those technologies, that's a whole new economy that we've created that is globally exportable and, you know, is an energy leader in the world, is something that we need to look at economically that also has a great impact and benefit of being good for the environment. So depending on how you want to look at it, if you have the motivation for good environmental practices, that's that way. If that's something that, you know, some people aren't motivated that way, but economically, for the stability of the country, for the success financially of the country, it's definitely something we need to continue to look at. And the rural communities play a big part in that. So that's one of the things that we need to continue to do. And like I said, if things like solar and wind aren't going to cut it, if that's not the technology, if it's not emerging is the way that we wanted to, we continue to invest and look at new things.
Yeah. So the other part of the question was, or the comment was,
didn't get it all. Sorry.
No, that's all right. That was part one, part two, that don't wind farms directly benefit people here? Meaning there's less coal fired power plant polluting our air and our water and our land. Yes. I agree with that. I just, you know, as a person running to represent, an area of people, I really appreciate hearing everybody's points of view. So I am endorsed by the Sierra Club, And I am definitely for the Illinois Clean Energy Jobs Act, which is exactly what we were talking about, you know, closing down the coal-fired plants, but making sure that we don't put those people out of work, that we have jobs for them and we have job training for them. And that's what the Clean Energy Jobs Act does. Exactly. So even though I'm endorsed by the Sierra Club and I want our environment cleaned up, I'm also endorsed by the AFL-CIO. And I want to make sure that our laborers and our workers aren't just put out of work. You know, we need to have a plan in place so that so that they have jobs to move into and hopefully create new jobs. And you know, just referring to listening to everybody's concerns, even though I really support wind power and solar power, I also want to hear you know, the concerns of the residents who have to live right next to the wind farms and drive on those roads and solar farms. It sounds like a great idea to me. It makes sense to me to have to take disused land and put solar panels on it. And I also would like to see, you know, more solar panels used on our houses and incentives for people, possibilities for people like me who live in a rented property. How do I get solar panels? You know, can I convince my landlord to get them? Or is there some way that as a renter that I can get solar panels? I don't know. But that's something that I would like to see.
Well, and that would be, I mean, things like that are stuff we need to look into, because you could incentivize rental property that has a large footprint to do that. And you can also incentivize by trying to, with the way you do that is also to have the rent maybe lower in places like that. So you incentivize by providing a subsidy to a landowner for installing that, but you can also incentivize people demanding that by subsidizing a rental. Essentially, if you rent from that place, maybe you get a little tax credit, things like that. We can continue to utilize when we recognize that those technologies are really useful. And I'm glad we brought up this too with the Clean Energy Jobs Act is, mm-hmm. I think the government failed a number of times in different industries and in somewhat of the auto industry and certainly in the parts of the country in the coal industry by not foreseeing what was going on and not having in place policies that helped retrain or find new jobs for workers. And instead what those types of industries recently, the administration would string people along and say, don't worry, your manufacturing jobs are coming back or your coal jobs are coming back. I'll make it happen. Vote for me, which is really just pandering to the worst extent. Cause we all know that those types of industries have changed and our economies have changed. Mm-hmm. But when our government fails us to that extent and then promises things they won't ever deliver, is a similar comparison that I see to some things with rural farming, with small farms and with rural communities. People promise them everything, but they have no policies to back it up. They say everything's great, don't worry, but where are the policies and the solutions that actually solve the problems that we're facing? So that's certainly one of the things we need to do, especially in these industries, as some of these jobs begin to phase out, is are we making sure that we're not failing our workers, are the people that have put in all the time and effort to do that. So I'm glad you bring that up, that it's a wonderful thing that government needs to have a little more foresight and not working in right now and make sure that there is a long-term plan. And that all goes to farming too. When we talk about trade agreements, is there a long-term plan in place? If we were going to change all these trade agreements, why didn't we have a plan in place for 3, 4, 5 years while the market was going to be so tumultuous while you make all these changes? Why wasn't there an initial plan in place to say, as we make these changes, when we come out on the other side, hopefully we're way better, but don't worry, we're not going to harm you while we do this. And the whole country is behind you. And we're going to have these programs to make sure that you're going to still be sustainable when we need you. And everything will be more profitable if we come out on the other side. So that kind of goes back to another question, but I just, that those things really get to me when I see people being failed by the government, when there are policies that can happen and they're given promises time after time for politicians, or they say everything's great, but they offer no solutions to any of the problems. They they offer no evidence that they've done anything beneficial. So we can move on to the next one. Otherwise I'd keep going all day. So
that's okay. Let's see. Blair, are there any more questions or comments at this time?
Oh, we actually have some comments. County board member happened to be watching. Thank you, Elizabeth. And so she actually was talking about how if wind solar energy is diverted to markets that will pay more for renewable, we're still benefiting from the taxes paid for the property value based on the operation. She also pointed out that upgrades to roads happen after construction finishes. The biggest complaint that she's seen from a wind farm that was not controlling the dust from construction that was impacting residential properties and raising health concerns.
So construction dust was a concern.
Yeah, but for the most part, and then there's a commenter who also agrees. We have two Joyces watching at the moment. So.
Okay. All right. Are there any more questions or comments we should address before we?
I don't think so. I think we're good for right now.
Talk about a couple other things.
Yep.
Okay. So one other thing I wanted to acknowledge is that some of the smaller farmers can't hire seasonal workers due to the cost of insurance. For instance, OSHA regulations for teen workers are so stringent that a small family farm can't necessarily afford to hire local teenage workers. And George, I wonder if, I wonder if some of our immigration policies can address that with permits for adult workers to come and work in our farms. I know I haven't been fortunate to have a conversation with a local farmer. Oh, lost George for just a sec.
Oh, yeah, sorry. That's my.
Sorry. I haven't been fortunate to have a conversation with a local farmer who uses migrant workers for harvest time, or for other farm work. But my understanding is that we do actually have migrant farm workers that work in Tazewell County. So I just wondered, George, if you had. If you had looked at some of the federal immigration policies with regards to migrant workers. Zoom life. Okay, and you accidentally muted yourself, George.
All right.
There we go.
A little technology snafus here and there.
All right.
No, I think we were talking about agriculture and immigration and farming. Mm-hmm. And I think we saw how big of an issue that is, especially in fruits and vegetables, a little bit more outside of the Midwest, but we certainly have some here. The H-2A visas that are issued that were going to be suspended for COVID for precautions of that for people coming from Mexico and from Central American, South American countries to work those jobs. I think one of the things that we absolutely need to do with agriculture, especially with farms, and the same thing that is reflected in small businesses, government needs to make it easier for people to work. So we need to make regulations are in place. And I worked as a labor and employment attorney for a couple of years. So I hold, and I've seen the downside of not following OSHA regulations and what happens when those things are skirted.
Yeah,
and
they can, devastating accidents.
Absolutely. And people can justify it as, oh, well, that shouldn't apply to me because we don't do this, or that shouldn't apply to me because we don't do this. One of the things we need to make sure that we have are that, and I don't want to use common sense as the landmark for it, but we need to have things that make sense for people that utilize them and have a little flexibility so that people can still get the job done without being so hampered by regulation, without losing what the purpose of those regulations are. So job safety always needs to be number one, but we need to make sure that we can allow people to continue to work. Part of the immigration reform, I think we need to see, because there are a lot of illegal immigrant workers that, you know, undocumented workers that work in the farming just field, essentially. Just it's one of those areas that pork production and cattle production and plants like that. We see a lot of immigrant workers, and I think one of the things we need to do are have policies that work well for the business owners and farmers, but also benefit workers who continue to come here, and that we benefit from their work, and have pathways to legitimate citizenship and for people that continue to come here, but also give flexibility to farmers and to business owners to allow people, if their work's going to be longer than a short-term visa allows, can we have them here and keep everybody on a well-documented field to be able to allow them to be here and have the flexibility for businesses to utilize that labor, because it's absolutely critical. And especially when we see we have regulations that don't allow people to utilize those types of things. And so we need to absolutely make it easier for people to work through regulations and not have to have teams of attorneys or to have consultants or to have accountants or anybody available just so they can get their job done on a day-to-day basis. I understand the purpose of those regulations, and I by no means want to eliminate what they do, but I certainly want to make it easier for people to navigate and utilize them while still holding that in place. And I know that's easy to say and harder to be done, but we need to make sure that that's the focus of policy, that it's not just to put a number of regulations in place on the legislative side, but not know how they're implemented and not be flexible with trying to be able to change them when we figure out what that actually does to people on the business side in the practicality, real life situation. So as far as immigration directly goes, like I said, I think we need to make sure that the policies of the past and past administrations and lack of enforcement, which has allowed workers to come and we've utilized their labor and we've reaped the benefits of it, but then we still call them illegal or we will, you know, depending on the whims of the new administration, how much enforcement's going to go on. And we certainly need to make sure that we regulate who comes in and out of the country, but also we need to allow the people that come here and we benefit from their work and in our economy to be able to legitimize them, you know, have a path to citizenship for them, and make sure that we have that stability for business and farmers to be able to utilize that. So that's, again, specifically, it's difficult to get into that because a lot of it's more of just implementation and having regulatory agencies and look at, you know, does the Department of Labor understand how agriculture works? Can, you know, should we look at the USDA having a labor enforcement arm to it? Or is there a policy that will work in conjunction to make sure that the Department of Labor is not enforcing or passing policies that actually don't work very well in the agriculture field? So I think there's a lot of that lack of analyzing regulations and figuring out how to implement them. And that's one of the things that we absolutely need to do. And to say that all this stuff is working great or to say that there's no problems in it is just completely untrue, because there are these implementation issues that businesses are then motivated to try to avoid because it makes it so difficult to work. And we need to make sure that everybody embraces the regulations for the purposes of what they are and not make them so difficult where they need to feel like they need to manipulate or avoid them.
Right, right. You know, and especially for small businesses, I mean, we've just witnessed businesses that didn't necessarily need millions of dollars in you know, paycheck protection program with the first COVID relief bill. You know, we saw businesses benefit who didn't really need it, and then we've watched valuable, beloved small businesses in our community close because they didn't have access to those funds, to those services. And I also think that we do our small businesses a disservice when we don't make enough allowances for them, you know, with regards to regulation. And again, I'm not remotely suggesting that worker safety be compromised, but we need to look at some creative solutions for protecting workers, making sure that workers have a living wage, but also making sure that our small businesses are able to operate and be successful. And it's tricky. It's not an easy thing to solve.
Not at all. And I think we need to see government more become a facilitator and less of an inhibitor when it comes to those things, especially small business and small farms. And part of that, I think, needs to be a focus when we're looking at regulations or looking at amending them or updating them, is to kind of do it from bottom up, from small farm up, from small business up. How does it affect below? And when we see the bailout programs, all of those and subsidies and things like that, or rebates, all of those things need to be done from smaller farm up and small business up. Mm-hmm. And typically they're not. And we saw that in the payment protection plan that all this money went out, all this money was supposed to save the economy. But then we continue to see small farms and small businesses go bankrupt because they had no access to that. And that's one of the issues that you see where government is not facilitating. And again, within the regulation part of it, we need to make sure that it's there to do its job. It's there to protect citizens, it's there to protect workers. It's not there to hold business back from growth or to have a chokehold on the economy.
Right.
And we need to find what that compromise is and make that an absolute focus. Because when you just look at, we're just going to lay a regulation or we're just going to allow this program to happen, well, if people don't know how to access it, small business doesn't know how to do it. And the implementation of that kind of goes back to not having long-term planning. There was no plan mm-hmm. of this in place. They kind of did it on the fly because nobody expected it, but I think you need to somewhat cliche, expect the unexpected. But if you're not long-term planning, you don't have the flexibility to be able to do any of that. You need to make sure you have all these things at least somewhat in place to understand how are we going to do it and what's the main focus going to be. So if the focus of subsidies is to help people farm, well, large corporate farms don't necessarily need that, and especially don't need it right away or in the instant when we have a large economic downfall, or that we have natural disasters, we have droughts, or we have things that affect small farmers so much more. Our policies need to make sure that they're reflective of that, and that their focus is to keep people going, not just reward people who have large amounts or who have a large contribution, because typically mm-hmm. they can absorb that anyway, and we can deal with that a little bit farther down the road. So the payment protection plan is a perfect example of government trying to do the right thing and just fumbling it.
Yep. I think, George, you're frozen. I hope you can still hear me, but thank you so much for that observation. Hopefully you'll bounce back here in a minute. There we go. There we go. Now you're back. Sorry. Yeah. You froze for a minute. That's there. Okay. And, but thank you, for that observation about, supporting our businesses from the bottom up. I mean, that's such a great observation. Well,
I was kind of getting to that, just to add as well, when we look at what's happened to our economy with COVID, with the retraction that we've had and what we've had to spend to try to stabilize the economy, all that money we're going to have to try to make back, and we're not going to make it back through tax cuts. We're not going to make it back through balancing budgets. We're going to make it back through growth. And growth traditionally happens on a broad scale from small businesses, from rural areas, from small farms. They have the ability to grow so much faster and to provide to the economy, because there's so many more of them providing and producing and adding to the economy, that we need to make sure we have policies to be able to grow the economy in these areas that have this area for growth. And that is the way long-term economy, we're going to be able to really stabilize again and continue to do that. So it's the top up focus, or the bottom up focus, is really something we need to do over a lot of industries.
Right. Right. Thank you so much for that. I'm going to check in with Blair and see if there's any more questions on the Facebook Live, since George and I are not trying to follow that while we're having our conversation.
So, it's actually, I think we're good. So.
Okay. All right. So I'm going to make a little pitch for myself, and then I'm going to let George make a little pitch for himself. A couple of things I wanted to point out to contrast myself with my opponent. My opponent voted against the 2019 Rebuild Illinois bill, which was an infrastructure stimulus bill that was put in place to repair roads and bridges that had been left unattended during the budget crisis during the Rauner administration. My opponent voted against that. We are already seeing the benefits of that. We're seeing the construction over the Illinois River in Peoria. We're seeing the road construction. Yeah, it's annoying, but everybody wants to drive on a nice smooth road. And that's jobs. And it's not just labor jobs. It's the materials, it's the machinery, it's the upkeep of that machinery. So these are important things, and I believe that my opponent voted against it simply because it was raising taxes and using money. And we need to look at the bigger picture. We need to look at the whole picture. When we raise a tax in order to pay for something, what are we getting from that? You know, let's look at that and let's think about the people that are going to benefit from that. And that is something, if I'm elected as your representative, that is something that I will do. I will talk to everybody and I will take into consideration when we're looking at budgets, how that's going to benefit everybody and how important that is. And I'll let George give a little pitch for himself. And then I'd like to get George's website put up on our Facebook page so that people find out where to check him out.
All right. Yeah. So when I talk to people, how I really differentiate myself from my opponent is asking them questions of people can tell you everything's great. They can tell you they've helped you out. They can tell you that everything's going well, that everything's never been better. But all you have to do is look at how confident are you about the future? How well are your friends and neighbors doing economically? How confident are they that they're going to be able to be sustainable in the future for them and their grandkids? Are we going to be able to have our rural communities sustainable in 10, 15, 20 years? Are they even going to be around? And so all of these things show me that, you know, the stock market might be doing great, but if you look around, how are our friends and neighbors getting along? Are we all financially doing well? Are we all secure? Do we all have retirement plans? Do we all have a job that's fulfilling and sustainable? Do we have economies that allow for our quality of life to continue to increase? And I don't see that in Central Illinois. I don't see that in our rural communities. I see a lot of things that scare me because these are my friends and neighbors. They are people I grew up with. They're people that I consider, you know, family, the extended family and friends and people that I talk with have genuine concerns that these issues are not only not being identified as problems, but you're certainly not going to have any solutions if you don't have somebody identifying that there is a problem. And the first step to solving that is identifying, yes, there are economic issues in Central Illinois that aren't being addressed. And I'm willing to do the work to make sure that we have solutions that are going to make us sustainable for generations to come and continue to grow rural America the way that it should be.
Great. Thank you so much. And I'll just have one more check to make sure there's no more questions. I don't want to leave anybody hanging.
I do appreciate that. We are good to go. So.
Okay. All right. Well, then I'm going to say thank you. Thank you, Blair, for hosting and keeping track of our Facebook. And thank you, George, for joining us. And thank you, everybody, for spending a little time on your Friday night to talk about farming and rural issues.
Well, this was great. Thank you for having me. And thank you for everybody for participating.
Okay, so we're off of Facebook Live.
Okay. All right. Okay. We're good.
Yeah. Thank you so much, George. Really
appreciate
it.
Thank you for everything. I wish we could have